Hello everybody. In this video, I will introduce you how policy makers can address resource use and stimulate urban actors towards more responsible use of resources. Actors are the units, people, organizations, companies, institutions who act, interact with each other. In this video, we aim to understand how the actions, decisions, and behavior of actors can be influenced towards more sustainable use of resources. In 1972, the Club of Rome, a group of experts concerned with the well-being of our planet, published its report Limits to Growth. In this report, they showed that there are thresholds in our natural ecosystems that, once trespassed, will lead to instability. There are limits to the carrying capacity of the Earth. Limits to the ability of the Earth to refill the stocks of resources used, and limits to cope with the negative effects of resource use, such as pollution, erosion, and degradation. With this work, and the work that followed, the Club of Rome played an important role in the framing of our current resource debate. They have contributed significantly to the development of environmental policies as we know them today. As you know, policies for better resource use and decoupling of resource use from economic growth intend to reduce the demand for a resource, reuse waste streams, and or recycle resources by putting them to new uses. Often, production chains are referred to as value chains, indicating that at every stage of production, value is being added. In particular for reuse and recycling, it is important to think in value chains, which is nothing else than a set of activities that are linked and in which value is added or even diminished. This is an important framework as it gets you to think about our waste as valuable resources. Take the example of recycling. Often, it involves a loss of quality, the downgrading of the quality of the material or matter. The product in which it is reused often has a lower added value. For example, the wastewater sludge and the phosphorus within it is usually incinerated. This leaves ash behind that is rich in phosphorus. This ash is often used in a lower quality, for instance, as a filling material in road construction. The phosphorus is then lost from the natural cycle. Preferably, reuse and recycling, they take place without loss of quality, or might even add to quality by upgrading the materials. Again, phosphorus can be used as a good example of this upgrading. Phosphorus is a scarce but indispensable resource for food production. Until recently, many of the nutrients in our urban waste flows have not been recovered. However, it is possible to utilize specific residual organic flows as a source of phosphorus from which products of the same or higher value can be created. So the phosphorus that was in the food can be recovered from the wastewater and then reused as fertilizer at the same value level as the fertilizer that was initially used to produce your food. In the Netherlands, it is therefore the ambition to turn the residual flows into a market. Stakeholders from the food industry, household waste processors, livestock farming, the water sector and the processing industry have joined forces to create a value chain. This will enable the Netherlands to concentrate, to scale up and increase the value and the export of green recycled flows of residual materials that are not currently being usefully reused in the Netherlands. The ambitions to reduce, reuse and recycle often need active stimulation, especially when it is cheaper to follow the linear model of extract, process, use, waste and dispose. Interventions are then needed to change this linear model to a more closed-loop model. Interventions can be targeted at different stages of the chain of production and consumption. Including consumption in the chain puts the focus on the consumer or user, emphasizing that also the consumer plays a role in changing the value of a product. And consumers are also actors with intervening power. Interventions can thus be initiated by different actors: public actors, private actors, and actors from civil society. I will discuss some commonly used policy interventions by the different groups of actors. Many government interventions make use of legal instruments. Laws and regulations have a general binding character. They address a wide audience without making exceptions. For example, the ban on landfill has led to the increased recycling of products and materials in the Netherlands. In 2015, even up to 96% of the total amount of waste produced was being recycled. However, much of the so-called recycling consists of the burning of materials in incinerators, generating heat and power. There is thus a big loss of quality in this form of recycling. Taxing is another commonly used policy intervention used by government. Concerning resource use, there are two big challenges with regards to taxes. The first is that in developed countries, labor is more heavily taxed than resource usage and environmental impact. This makes the take, make, waste, dispose approach more attractive than the reduce, reuse, and recycle strategy. The second related challenge is that many of the value chains have become globally scattered, realizing production in those places where costs are least. Countries with low wages and minimum environmental regulations are attractive places to move production to. Many countries use the argument of displacement as an excuse for not taking action. Displacement concerns the moving of jobs and industries to other countries due to less favorable competitive conditions. International collaboration and coordination of policies and regulations are therefore needed. Back to the phosphorus example. In 2014, the EU added phosphorus to the list of critical materials, materials for which there is a shortage of supply and for which there are no alternatives. This inclusion of phosphorus in the European Critical Raw Materials list will drive development of EU policies to promote sustainable phosphorus management, data gathering on resources and use, research and development, and recovering and recycling policies. EU regulation is a first important step towards coordinated action by the EU member states. But also the private sector can regulate. There are many forms of self-regulation that can also be used to contribute to more responsible resource use. Examples are the norms and standards for products and processes, such as those from the International Standards Organization, ISO. Often, such norms are made part of the formal legal framework as well. Another example is the Global Reporting Initiative that provides guidelines for reporting on the activities of the company and its supply chain. These forms of self-regulation not just require coordination amongst the different private actors in a sector. In turn, a single company also consists of many actors who need to adapt their products, practices, and routines to comply with the self-imposed norms and standards. An example of a private sector-initiated voluntary initiative is the phosphorusplatform.eu. In this platform, organizations and industries from all over Europe come together to exchange best practices for recovery and reuse of phosphorus, and, of course, to lobby policymakers. Like government regulations, private sector regulation is also difficult to change. For example, private companies have invested in complying with the self-imposed norms and standards and accounting systems. Therefore, they are reluctant to change these institutionalized rules and regulations. The changes usually meet resistance and involve a lengthy process of interaction and negotiation. A final form of intervention I will discuss here is that of labelling and certification. These systems are often a hybrid form of government regulation and private sector regulation. Examples are the green building certificates that are handed out by private sector collaboratives, but also in the production of timber, food, and clothing, such certification systems are expected to contribute to more sustainable products. The use of private green labels and certificates can be supported with government incentives, such as tax advantages and subsidies. Such labels and certificates also facilitate green procurement. A well-known example are the fair trade certification systems, which allow private and public organizations to consider social and environmental effects of production in their procurement policies and decisions. There are thus many policy instruments addressing resource use: administrative regulation, standards and norms, accounting and reporting systems, certification schemes, and taxes are only some of the groups of policy instruments you can think of. These policies and instruments are often developed and implemented in close interaction with the industry, relying on the self-regulating capacity of industries. However, there are many barriers that may limit the success of these policy instruments. Just think of the lock-in effect of norms, standards, and accounting procedures. Many production processes are tailored to comply with these procedures. Change of procedures may involve costly changes of production processes. Also, actors usually try to shift responsibilities to other places, other actors, or other parts of the value chain. This is what happens when production is moved to countries with low wages and weak environmental regulations. To avoid such shifts, policies should incentivize, reduce, reuse, and recycle in a comprehensive way. Targeting the design stage instead of the end-of-life stage could lead to products that take resource use throughout the life cycle into account. Design for reuse and recycling is a much more promising way than trying to reduce the environmental impact of products and processes after they have been designed and produced. Policies that reward the responsible use instead of the irresponsible use of resources are much needed. Change driven by voluntary initiatives can deliver change without waiting for change in formalized policies of government and industries. By showing what is possible, such voluntary policies can lead to changes in the formalized policies. So, when do you start taking the initiative? If you think of your personal food and water usage, what could you do yourself to reduce consumption? How much do you waste? How could you contribute to reuse and recycling? And what would you expect of others to facilitate your responsible resource use? Please think about it.